instead of music?
Yeah.
Okay.
Sustainable development has become the popularized expression for Agenda 21. Agenda 21 is the 1992 United Nations Rio Declaration on the Environment and Development.
It is the agenda for the 21st century you're living in today. For a brave new world where everything that you cherished and held true will no longer exist.
Agenda 21 defines itself as the comprehensive plan of action to be taken globally, nationally, and locally by organizations of the United Nations systems.
It also elevates nature above man. And it contains something called the precautionary principle, where basically you're guilty until you're proven innocent.
Sustainable development is the philosophy designed to bring human beings across the globe under the full control of a narrow human elite.
It's a 40-chapter document to basically control the world. It's based entirely on socialist control mechanisms.
Sustainable developers have designed a global movement coordinated through a global to local action plan to create world government in accordance with certain objectives. These objectives include an end to national sovereignty, the abolition of private property, the restructure of the family unit, and increasing limitations and restrictions on mobility and individual opportunity.
The Green Goal includes the listings of what's not sustainable. A couple of the examples include private property.
728 lists fossil fuels.
Golf courses and ski lodges are not.
Consumerism.
Irrigation is not sustainable.
Paved roads.
Commercial agriculture.
Herbicides, pesticides. Elsewhere, it lists farmlands, pastures, grazing of livestock.
And the family unit.
The focus of sustainable development is the abolition of private property, societal undermining of the family, and abandonment of the constitutional protection of unalienable rights as described in the Declaration of Independence.
You see, I sat on the Santa Cruz Agenda 21 committees. Now, this was a lot of crazy ideas. This is back in the mid-90s. Crazy ideas I heard. Mother Earth's surface wasn't to be scratched. Human beings were to be concentrated into human settlement zones. Educational systems were to focus on the environment as the central organizing principle. All aspects of life were covered. Well, I went to these committees at the request of some people who told me that I needed to understand what was going on, and I came back and I said, this is craziness. This is so silly. It has no chance of having any effect on our society. Well, I was wrong.
The United States government's support for sustainable development, Agenda 21, is very clear. In 1992, while the Rio conference was going on, George Bush, then president, was there where he executed the Agenda 21 protocols on behalf of the United States and brought it back to Washington, D.C. Within a year, Bill Clinton, by executive order, no congressional review, established the President's Council for Sustainable Development. In Santa Cruz, we've got a two-lane freeway system. We need four, but what we're getting is hundreds of millions of dollars of federal money to take a dilapidated rail line that Southern Pacific wants to put in the hands of somebody else so that a commuter line can be built along the railroad track that'll be followed by 14-story buildings where people will live and stack them and pack them units, where developers or so-called sustainable developers will build these high-rises with federal dollars. In fact, Santa Cruz has received a $300 million federal grant to build the first 3,000 of these stack and pack them units. The County Board of Supervisors has said, if you are a sustainable developer, you're immune from any construction defect liability. It's a partnership between selected developers building this new world order and the government using the American taxpayer dollars in order to do it. This is a map of the Wildlands Project. to explain the map, the red are areas that are to be off limits to human beings. No resource development, no human activity. If you live there, you won't. The yellow areas are the areas for major control of all human activity. If you live there, you won't. The black areas, the black dots, are the smart growth zones. That's where human beings are to be stacked and packed in small living units along rail tracks. The smart growth program ultimately has jobs assigned and children cared for by the state.
The question has been asked many times, how the people who are perpetrating these things expect to do this and make it last. The answer to that is that you steal a generation of children and you indoctrinate them so that they accept these ideas and they become global citizens in the coming global village.
UNESCO came out and declared 2005 to 2015 the decade of education for sustainable development. But they go on to say that it will encompass the 40 chapters of Agenda 21. That is your federal national curriculum. The entire purpose of second grade social studies is to transfer loyalty from the family to the government and teach them about sustainable economic consumption. Students construct their own understandings of reality and realize that objective reality is not knowable. So why bother? The truth is, the truth, which keeps men free, is being suppressed in order to prop up the attitude training agenda. And it moves on. This is our new math called Connected Mathematics. Standard 3 tells us that students learn that mathematics is man-made, that it is arbitrary, and good solutions are arrived at by consensus. Most of us assume 2 plus 2 is always going to equal 4. You're wrong. We might reach a new consensus. How well does it work? Well, they tell you. In the teacher's guide in the back, it tells us that because the curriculum doesn't emphasize arithmetic computations done by hand, some students may not do as well on tests assessing computational skills. We believe such a trade-off in the favor of CMP is very much to the student's advantage in the world of work. Our children are mathematically illiterate on purpose. How do I know on purpose? Why isn't this just a basic bad idea? Because the Sustainable Development Plan tells us so. Generally, more highly educated people who have higher incomes consume more resources than poorly educated people who tend to have lower incomes. In this case, more education increases the threat to sustainability. Charlotte Iserby, I owe you an apology. I did not believe for the longest time it was a deliberate dumbing down. I thought the dumbing down was a natural consequence of a bad idea. Folks, it's deliberate. It's deliberate.
The sustainable globalist goal is the orchestration of a planned fall of American principles, values, and lifestyles. The effect on the average American will be devastating. With modernizing technology, the ordinary person will live without independence, privacy, or substantive rights.
Another press conference that I attended was the ICLE group, the International Committee for Local Environmental Initiatives. It helps in the implementation of Agenda 21 in all of our local communities. And one of the speakers was a Harvey Reuven, who happens to be the vice chair of ICLE. And I asked him about the correlative rights that Americans derive from the United States Constitution and the Bill of Rights. And that, of course, is your individual liberties, your private property, your freedom of speech. I asked about it clashing with Agenda 21. And you know what his response was?
Individual rights must take a back seat to the collective.
This is Pastor Jason Cooley with Sound the Battle Cry Radio Ministries here with Brother Nate. And you just heard some interesting facts about Agenda 21. And we're going to kind of bring this all together for you here. There's a lot going on, actually, in this clip that we just played for you, and it was played on purpose, so you could listen to it and relate to the next bit of news that we're going to bring you to kind of focus this in and narrow this in a little bit. Who's pushing this agenda? Well, a lot of people are pushing it, but who in power is pushing this agenda? Well, that old wicked devil in Rome, the Pope, and his Jesuit order, they are pushing it through their various knighthoods and everything else that they have and their people that they have in place. But the Pope is pushing Agenda 21, but he's pushing it, you know, through his papal, how do you say that word, encycles? Is that how you say it?
I say encyclical, or you'd say encyclical.
Encyclical, through his popsicle. I don't know, whatever you want to call it. There anyway, through his writings, he's going to write a papal bull about it, right? I mean, I think he's going to, isn't he? Like a command or something, so to speak, or the strongest form of language. I think eventually he's going to write about that, which is the strongest form of language that he can absolutely write about that, the papal bulls or whatever. But anyway, he's got this teaching or whatever that he's doing on this. And we find it ironic that as we were doing some digging around here, all this was just Agenda 21.
That's all it is. Yep.
And it's just said in the Pope's language here. And wait till you see what he wants to do. And that's really what we're going to talk about today is what he wants to do to America, to the world, but especially to America and to his citizens.
Yep.
And it's sad is what it is, basically. Go ahead, Brother Nate.
Yep. Well, I just wanted to say something real quick. So, you know, there's a lot of information in that clip. So what I want to do is, real quick, talk about the four E's of Agenda 21. And this will kind of summarize a lot of stuff that we just heard. And I want you to remember these things as we talk about what Pope Francis says and see that he's saying the exact same thing that Agenda 21 is trying to push. Okay, so the four E's of Agenda 21 are this: education, equity, economy, and environment, okay? And now we'll break down these and explain what they mean by each individual one. So they tried, now they're not as what they appear. They always try to present it as something good.
Well, it's like the Patriot Act.
Yeah.
Oh, that sounds great. The Patriot Act.
Patriot.
We're all patriotic, right? No, patriotic is not kicking your door in and throwing you in a cell somewhere.
It's the classic problem, reaction, solution.
Right.
Agenda that they do, the tactic, the Hegelian dialectic. So they artificially create a problem. You got artificially created terror.
Uh-huh.
And then the people react. Oh, no, something's got to be done. Well, how about we take away some of your freedoms in order to keep you more safe? Let's, you know, have unreasonable searches and seizures. We'll check all your phone calls and your emails. We'll patch you down and fill you up at the airport with TSA and all this other stuff.
Right.
And that's in order to keep you safe.
Right. We want to keep you safe.
So that was the agenda even before they did that. It was
That's right.
To take away your freedom.
Right.
But they couldn't just do it by saying, hey, give up your freedom.
They hate us for our freedom, so we'll take it all away from you.
Right, exactly. So they had to create the problem first.
That's right.
So anyways, they presented it as something good. Now, education. Let's hit the first E. Education sounds good, right?
Yeah.
Well, what do they mean by education? They mean by education indoctrination into believing that nature is more important than man. And the group is more important than the individual. Now, you remember the creepy ending to that clip?
Yeah.
He said, you must assimilate into the Borg, into the collective.
Right.
The collective is more important than the individual.
Right.
It's called collectivism.
Right. The Pope hates individual rights. Okay. And the reason he hates individual rights is because after the Protestant Reformation and the rise of the King James Bible, the 1611, what that did was it invigorated people, it energized people to fight for their rights. See, putting the Bible in the common man's vulgar language, excuse me, what that did was it took his power away.
That's right.
Okay.
Pope's temporal power.
Yeah,
it broke
the temporal power of the Pope.
The King James Bible broke that.
Exactly.
Right.
So when it broke his power, the only nation that ever really organized the correct way in the sense of outside of a king and outside of the authority of a pope or anything else was the first was Rhode Island, would be considered the state of Rhode Island.
Yep.
Okay. And I know there's other people that tried, but they were theocracies for the most part. But, you know, you have Rhode Island, you have the other ones, and then you have the United States of America, or America, however you want to call it. I don't want to get too technical here. But anyway, basically, you had these nations, that you had these groups of people that started. But where did
the Bill of Rights come from?
Right. The Bill of Rights came from pressure from John Leland and the Baptists in Orange County, okay, in Orange County, Virginia. They pushed James Madison for a Bill of Rights. Okay, they pushed it for the Congress. They would not ratify, and they would not move ahead, and they would not elect James Madison and help him in his election process.
So we would not have a Bill of Rights if it weren't for Baptists, if it weren't for Christians.
Exactly. Who held to
the King
who
James
held to,
Bible,
right? And the inalienable rights of a man. Okay. To be able to believe what he wanted to. Okay, freedom of conscience.
The rights that come from God.
Right, that come from God alone. Freedom of conscience is one of those rights. Mm-hmm. And the Pope hates freedom of conscience. He absolutely stands opposed to freedom of conscience.
That's right.
He just absolutely stands opposed to
it. So those two major points in education that they're indoctrinated into, which you can see, we can see this has been going on for a while, can't we?
Yes.
In public schools, they're taught that the group is more important than the individual.
Right.
And where do we see that we see that in a lot of aspects of society. In school we see it, but we also see it in sports. You always got to be part of the team, and this team, your team fights against this team, and you're always part of this group. You always have to be, and you can never go against the group. Don't ever go against the
herd.
You
can't be an individual.
You can't be an individual and have freedom of thought and an individual opinion. And I noticed this when I was in school. Whenever you were not taught critical thinking abilities. Problem-solving abilities. You were just taught to mindlessly regurgitate what you were taught in
the books.
Right. And when you mindlessly regurgitate the answer, they gave you a good grade.
That's right.
If you just repeated whatever they wanted you to say and just be a carbon copy of everyone else, that's what they want. So the group is more important than the individual. You see that in society, too. When you step out of the status quo in so many different areas of society, even in Christianity, you go look. They got the collectivism mentality. You go against the grain, against the herd in Christianity.
Yeah,
you're
going to
be singled out. Yeah, you're going to be stomped on. You're going to be slandered. You're going to be attacked. So that's, you can see that all over society. But what's the other aspect of indoctrination? Believing that nature is more important than man. Do we see that?
Yep. Well, the Bible warned us about that, didn't it? That they wanted to serve the creature,
worship
more
the creature.
Than the creator, yep. More than the creator, who is God.
That's
blessed
right.
Forever. Amen. That's what the Bible says. So these are all aspects of leaving the one true God. These things are found in Romans chapter 1 as well.
Right.
They're, it's a blueprint. Romans chapter 1 is like a blueprint of the New World Order scheme and what happens when people are turned over to that reprobate.
Absolutely.
And we're seeing it right now. We're seeing it every day more and more.
So Agenda 21, this comes from the United Nations, just so everyone knows. So believe that nature is more important than man. Well, how can we see some examples of that? Well, in this country, we believe that it's no big deal to kill babies in the womb. Over 50 million babies have been killed since 1973, since Roe versus Wade was passed in this country. Yet, we will fight tooth and nail to protect some endangered fish, you know.
That's
Or some a bird.
Or an
or
owl.
Something, an owl.
Bird.
Some
yep.
bird.
Yep.
Or an area of trees.
Yeah,
I mean,
a tree. Yeah.
Now, what is that showing? The value of life.
Right.
That they place more value on an animal and nature in a tree than they do a baby in the womb.
Yep.
Totally twisted the values upside down.
And they've been educated in indoctrinated, which really that word education in their sense
is indoctrination.
Indoctrination. And they've been indoctrinated to accept all that.
Exactly.
The reason why we're in the shape we're in right now is because all these children have been indoctrinated with this for years. So they can't tell the difference in a stupid kitty cat and a human being, okay?
Because of evolution.
I don't hate kitty cats. Yep. I don't like them that much. But I don't. I'm a dog person. Sorry, I got a dog. But the point is that I don't want to hurt it, and I know the difference in between a cat and a human, okay?
Right.
I understand the difference, and I understand what God gave man dominion over. Well, these children are taught they're just part of the evolutionary process.
Because they're taught evolution.
Right, so they're taught they're part of the evolutionary process, and you're just
an animal.
Right, you're just an animal. That's all you are. You just have a little bit better communication skills than your...
You're more highly evolved.
Right, than your cousin, the ape.
Right, okay? Exactly. So that's some of the indoctrination. Let's see some of the other points that fall under education. The new purpose of education is to learn values, not facts. Now, that's I think that's interesting because it's not real values, it's their values.
Right.
Which are mainly what you would call liberal.
Right.
In society, the left-wing liberal values
fascist.
That they have.
Right.
Right. Well, I would call right-wing fascist. I'd call left-wing communist.
Right, right. Yep.
A little bit.
Yep. Yep.
But anyways, they're still bad.
Yep.
And then students must become... Now, hold on. Learn values, not facts. That's an important point, though, because you run into a lot of people where they don't
the
really...
The facts don't matter to
the
them.
The facts just don't matter
My
to them.
My feelings are
it's
what
all
matter.
About feelings. You know? Man, we'd go down a long rabbit trail with that.
Yeah, we could.
Let's keep going. Students must become global... not American citizens. Now, that is a huge agenda that we're going to see in the article we're going to read, the statements that Pope Francis made.
That's right.
Okay.
That's right. Interesting, isn't it, though?
Yep.
That's the goal. And we're seeing that. Oh, no, we're citizens.
We're supposed
Haven't
to be,
you heard
we're
this
supposed
in
to
music?
Be citizens of the globe.
We've been
global
hearing this,
citizens,
right.
Not American citizens.
We've been hearing this in music and everything. You hear these concepts of being a global citizen.
We are
citizen.
The world.
We are the world. Remember that? Wow. At least you didn't sound like Michael Jackson when you did that.
Yeah.
Yeah, that'd be bad.
I wasn't trying
but,
to.
But that's good. I'm glad. But remember that song, We Are the World. I was a little
yep.
kid. I remember watching that and seeing that on there.
That was pushing that agenda.
Right, absolutely was pushing that agenda. And, you know, basically, that Captain Planet cartoon
yep.
we just talked about when I was a kid. I listened to the Captain Planet cartoon push the same thing. You're global citizens. You're all global citizens.
That's right.
We're connected together globally.
They don't want you, like we said, they want you to give up. Well, anyways, we'll continue on. Okay, so that's the education, E. Let's go to the next E, equity. Well, what does that mean? Sounds good, right? Sounds like
yeah.
they're going to be fair.
Oh, that's good stuff.
It's
equity.
About
right.
being fair. No, what that means is theft of private property, open borders, remove God, morality, and responsibility.
Yep.
Now, the more that we learn about Agenda 21, the more we see that we've been following it play by play, point by point. To the T.
Yeah, you know, it's interesting. Open
theft of private property.
Theft
start
of private
there.
Property. Let's just think about that. Theft of private property. We are seeing that everywhere. We saw it at the, you know, whether it was a, you know, whatever. Things like the Bundy Ranch.
The
okay?
Bundy Ranch, right?
Okay, we saw it there. We saw the theft of private property there.
Now, what is the principle that they based that off of, though? Was that land, but land belongs to the federal government and
right.
not individual citizens. How can the federal government, they say they own any land?
Right, and they shouldn't own
they
anything.
They shouldn't.
No, private property is what this right. nation was founded upon.
Right.
But which is one of the Bill of Rights, you know, was
right.
private property. So theft of private property, we are seeing that ever. Rezoning through zoning.
Yep.
Through zoning laws, we've seen the theft of private property. We've
eminent
seen,
domain. Government
right,
can
eminent,
just come in and claim your property.
Right, exactly. Eminent
Kick
domain. That's right. Eminent domain is one of those. So that was an Agenda 21. That's part of that whole
you know,
agenda.
And you could also say that you don't really own your property because of property taxes.
Right. You never really own it. You, never
you
really.
Think you own your property? Stop paying property taxes. And
see who
what
comes
happens.
And takes it. Right.
Exactly. See what happens.
Yep. See who comes and takes it. Then the next one, you have open borders.
Yep.
Now, listen, folks. The Pope's
we don't
been,
see that, do we?
Yeah. The Pope's been screaming about that forever. What I can't figure out is why libertarians want it.
Right.
It just baffles my
now,
mind.
Why would a libertarian want a point in the Agenda 21?
I don't know.
They
because
think that's a constitutional principle?
I hear Baptist libertarian people, and they are shucking and juking and jiving and shucking for what? For
open
borders. I'm like, why would you want open borders? Nations have borders.
There's nothing wrong with having borders.
No.
You're not discriminating against people. You're not hating people.
And
it's not
a lack
like
of liberty either.
Yeah, it's not like you refuse to help them. It's you just have laws. You have boundaries.
Right. Nations have borders. They always have. Look in the Bible. All nations had borders,
yeah,
okay?
Don't remove the ancient landmark.
Right. I mean, come on. It's just it's a scriptural principle. Oh, no, we should have open borders. Let anybody. Are you nuts? No nation ever had open borders like that was successful. That
well, whenever
that
it happened,
viability.
It caused a
Once
downfall,
they did.
Like
it,
the Roman Empire.
Like the Roman Empire, when they opened up their borders like that. It's just ridiculous.
Caused a downfall.
You know, it's a plot of the devil. I'm
and
sorry,
then, and then for the equity, they remove God, morality, and responsibility. Obviously, we see
yep.
that all
I mean,
over
it's
the place.
Not hard to understand they remove God.
All right, let's look at the 30, economy. All right, so what do they mean by that? They want to help our economy? Well, they always say they want to help the poor, right?
Yeah.
And Pope Francis is the poor pope. He wants to help the poor.
The best way to help a poor person is give them a job.
Scrape off some gold off your...
If the Pope really wanted to help somebody, I mean...
Scrape some gold off your throne.
I can think of a lot of redistribution. wealth.
Don't they have the most, Vatican. I think they have the biggest collection of gold in the world.
Yeah.
They own the most. So anyways, this is what they mean, redistribution of America's wealth. How? Which ways?
Foreign countries
by outsourcing jobs, factories, and technology, creating massive unemployment.
What were those trade agreements, Brother Nate?
NAFTA. Oh, that was a big one that Bill Clinton was involved in. NAFTA. Outsourcing companies. Like, for instance, my grandfather worked for this company, General Electric. He worked there for 20-something years. And they're like, oh, sorry, we're moving the company to China. See you later.
Yep.
And he was left with nothing.
Yep.
See ya. No loyalty. No, nothing. See you later.
Yep.
And then what does Walmart do? They
outsource everything to China.
They outsource to China. Now, let me explain something for those of you who don't know. I'm sure most people know about Walmart and their cheap stuff. Now, do you know why Walmart has such cheap prices? And I hear conservatives say this all the time, though. Conservatives think that they're defending capitalism, okay? When they say, "Well, you shouldn't talk against corporations. You sound like a liberal," you know?
Right.
And they're like, "They're allowed to do whatever they want and blah blah blah." You know, let me tell you something. You know why they're allowed to it's called artificially low prices, okay? Artificially low. Why do they think so cheap? I'll tell you why. Because the labor in China, they pay them extremely low wages, horrible working conditions, and in some places it was so bad at the factories over there, they put nets around the buildings because people were jumping off the top of the buildings and committing suicide.
That's right.
They got caught with their children chained to a street post while they're at work. Little 2- and 4-year-olds.
And they work those people to death.
They work them to death, okay? So you can have your little $5 Snuggie from Walmart or whatever it is.
Snuggies? Yeah, you know, or your cell phone.
Cheap electronics.
I mean, I have a cell phone too, so I'm not
all
I'm
that
just
stuff.
Saying that's where our smartphones and all that stuff is made for the most part, and that's what they're doing with most of it.
Right. I'm not saying, "Oh, we can avoid shopping at all corporations," but you have to understand, you know, ethically where that comes from. That's wrong. That's not right to do that.
And it's a part of Agenda 21.
Right. It's a part of Agenda 21. It's not a principle of true capitalism. That's called, Ron Paul called that crony capitalism.
That's what it is.
Okay? If you want to help this country, don't outsource your company's labor to another country.
Right.
That does not help this country whatsoever.
No, it never has. In fact, if you study the Roman Empire, if you study the Roman Empire, you will understand the reason the fall of the Roman Empire was they stopped making things.
Right.
And they sent their slave labor over, and I forget who they had do it, but they had slave labor do it that were immigrants or whatever.
Right.
And they did all the cheap labor for them, and Rome stopped making stuff. Like, their people stopped being productive. Their people stopped working, and they ended up trashed.
And
the society
that's what's
did.
Happened to us.
And bread and circuses came in.
Yep.
So they entertained them because they had nothing better to do, so they gave them their food, and they gave them their entertainment, their bread and their circuses.
As a nation, we've stopped producing, and
that's
we've
right.
become a completely a consumer nation.
Right.
All we do is consume.
Which a nation cannot survive off of that, by the way.
No. And that's why we're in so much debt to China.
That's right.
They own a lot of our debt.
Right.
So, okay. So that's the economy. Want to do redistribution of America's wealth, which is communism, by the way.
Yeah, and they're not hiding it either.
Okay. Now, let's talk about something real quick. Liberals always talking about, well, give to the poor. The government gives to the poor. And if you don't want the government to give to the poor, then you're just a hateful, and you're supposed to be conservative. You're supposed to be a Christian. You don't want to help people. What's wrong with you? No, I don't believe it's the government's job to do that.
Right.
It's the right of individuals, private citizens, the right of churches to help people. Yes, they have an obligation to do that. Churches, individuals, people, they should help the poor.
That's right.
They private citizens can set up charities. They can set all kinds of stuff.
We did for many years.
Yeah, they can set up homeless shelters and soup kitchens and all that type of stuff. We're saying that, yes, we want to help people, but it's not the government's job to forcibly take money from you and then decide for you what they're going to do with your money and who they're going to give it to.
That's right.
That's wrong, and that is a communistic principle. All right, and the last point of the four E's is environment. Nature is more important than man. That's what we saw. That's part of the principle of education they're learning. The new God is Mother Earth.
That's it right there. Nature is more important than, and we see this rise of this Gaia spirit, this this spirit of the earth, this mother spirit.
Worship the earth.
Of the earth. Worship the earth. And the earth is crying out. Mother Nature is crying out.
That's what environmentalism is based off of.
That's just pagan witchcraft is all that is.
Yes, because witches worship the earth.
That's right.
It's an earth religion. And phony science creates phony regulations, destroying energy independence and industry. Okay, phony science. What are we talking about here? Well, we're going to be talking about in a second global warming and climate change. That's what the Bible would call science falsely so-called.
Yeah, it's a joke.
Okay.
By the way, you can't shake your fist at heaven anymore and mock the Creator anymore by saying that we as man, we'll be able to destroy this earth. And, we can destroy it, and God can't do anything about it. And it's just ridiculous.
It's just going to wipe out
humanity. Right, right. We are strong as a Creator. And that's the height of arrogance is what it is, people. It's just the absolute height of arrogance.
But this phony science, this climate change, what are they trying to do? They're trying to create phony regulations. They're trying to create tax, destroying energy independence and industry. They don't want us drilling for oil here. They want to import the oil. They've been doing that, right? Why? So we're dependent on foreign countries.
Right.
Oh, by the way, redistribution of wealth. I forgot to make this point. Redistribution of America's wealth to foreign countries. How much money do we give to other countries?
Billions.
Billions.
Upon billions.
And countries that hate us. Mm-hmm. Why have we given millions of dollars to countries like Egypt and all these other Arab countries,
so we can control
some of these countries that have turned around and gone against us. You know,
so we can control them, because that's what the Roman Empire did. Because we're not a republic, we're an empire.
It's also to weaken this country.
Right, and it is weakening it. We're giving away our resources. Hillary Clinton gave away, not to mention what Bill gave away when he was in office, but Hillary Clinton, as she was the Secretary of State, gave away deals to, I think it was Russia, from the U.S., deals that would have made us money, she handed them over to Russia and other countries. I think China too, maybe. I'm not sure.
And so this environmentalism, each policy and regulation is in place to control more and more of your life. So we'll talk about that a little bit more in the show. But environmentalism is one of the biggest agendas in this Agenda 21 that they're going to use to create a new world order.
That's right. And it's a religion, by the way. It is an absolute religion, and it is one that the Pope is the head of.
All right, let's get going on this article here and see what the Pope has said.
All right. You want me to do mine from the Western Journal first?
Sure, let's do it.
Western Journalism first. Vatican advisor says America's founding document is outmoded. Reveals global game plan.
Wow, founding document. So he's saying the United States Constitution is outmoded.
Well, he's talking about the Declaration of Independence, but I'm sure he's including the Bill of Rights.
Right.
In his language, though, he includes the Bill of Rights, and I'll get to that, okay?
Okay.
Top Vatican advisor Jeffrey Sachs. I wonder if he's related to Goldman and Sachs at all.
I don't know.
It's spelled the same way. Isn't that right? S-A-C-H-S?
Yep, it looks like it. Yep.
Well, it's interesting, isn't it? Couldn't be, right? Top Vatican advisor Jeffrey Sachs says that when Pope Francis visits the United States in September, he will directly challenge the American idea, in parentheses, by the way, of God-given rights embodied in the Declaration of Independence.
All right. So now we start to see Pope's agenda. One of the reasons why he's coming here to speak at Congress is to challenge our idea of God-given rights as embodied in the Declaration of Independence.
By the way, can I –
why would he want to do that?
Well, because he's a devil, that's why. But you know, he's a Jesuit, and that's what he does.
That's right.
And they don't serve the God of the Bible. They serve Lucifer, the god of this world. Nate, I find it interesting here, though. And the reason I do is because if I was a Republican that was against all these things, like the Republican John Boehner is supposed to be.
Yeah, they're supposed to be. Santorum, they say that they're upset about what the Pope's been saying about these things.
Well, John Boehner invited the Pope to speak.
Yeah, right, and he said he was excited about it.
Right, he said he was excited about it, and the Pope is going to come and he's going to speak. And this is the message that he's going to bring Congress. So, I mean, wait a minute now. I thought the Republicans were supposed to be the good guys. I thought the Republicans were supposed to be the ones that were on the side of liberty and truth and all that kind of stuff. No, they're not. They're all on the same team.
Well, let's talk about that for a second. John Boehner, Jesuit trained.
That's right.
He is Jesuit trained. And what about Rick Santorum? He's a Knight of Malta.
He's a Knight of Malta.
So on the surface, they appear that they're against each other, but that is a lie. It's an illusion. They are secretly on the same team. They're on the same side.
Right. And what you have to understand is if you ever study anything, and by the way, we're going to be doing some shows in the future. When I get back probably from our trip, I've got to take a trip down to Atlanta and be gone for about a week or so. But when I get back, we want to start a series sometime soon on the Jesuits and really explain to you what's going on and how they work. But that's exactly what's happening. They act like they're enemies. And they're not; they're actually friends,
right?
Because then you see them next. Then you'll see them at that comedian event where they're all laughing and joking,
yeah,
and telling
exactly.
jokes about each other and mocking. Oh, I'm still looking for those WMDs. Is what
yeah,
Bush
exactly.
said at that meeting, and everything, and everybody, ha 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 ha, and everybody's laughing. It's like, I mean, do you understand this is like a bad episode of WWF wrestling?
Just like professional wrestling.
It is just like professional wrestling. I mean, you know, nothing will shatter you the most. And if you're a little kid and you see like Hulk Hogan and the Ultimate Warrior are like enemies, and then you see them after a show when they're walking out of a show and they're high-fiving each other, talking
hanging out and
having fun. Wait a minute. I thought you two hated each other. Nope, that's just part of the gimmick, man. That's just
right.
part of the gimmick. And that's what this is. That's just part of the gimmick is all it is. They don't really have
yep.
any – because real people that would have a problem with this would tell the Pope, don't come. You're not welcome.
Yeah, don't come.
Don't come. See, you're not welcome here. You're not speaking here.
That's right.
See, anyway, so Sachs, a special advisor to the United Nations and director of the Earth Institute at Columbia University. You know, why is it always at a university? Why are these people always connected to higher education? Well, because most higher education is antichrist. I didn't say all of it. Most of it is, though. It's the Bible talks about the wisdom of this world, the wise of this world, okay?
Right.
And how God is foolishness to God. Anyway, so at Columbia University is a media superstar who can always be counted on to pontificate, that's an interesting word, and endlessly on such topics as income inequality,
yep.
global health. This time, writing in a Catholic publication, he may have gone off his rocker. So this article says, revealing the real global game plan. Well, he just let it out. He let the cat out of the bag, didn't he? I don't think they made a mistake. I think they do it on purpose. They release this information, get you wondering a little bit, get you frantic a little bit, see what you're going to do with it. And then if you let it go, then they know they can start implementing it. If you raise up stink, then they know they can only push little bits through. Okay?
Yep.
That's how they work. All right? All right. So the United States, Sachs writes in his – oh, this is interesting. The United States, Sachs writes in the Jesuit publication America.
Yep. That's the Jesuit publication. It's called America.
That's interesting, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. So he's writing in that.
Yeah, that's interesting.
What does he say?
Is a society in thrall to the idea of unalienable rights to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness? But the urgent core of Francis's message will be to challenge this American idea by proclaiming that the path to happiness lies not solely or mainly through the defense of rights, but through the exercise of virtues. Most notably, justice and charity.
Okay. I'm about to get sick from this garbage.
Yeah, I know.
So, Pope Francis has a problem with us wanting to defend our constitutional rights. The rights of America. He's got a problem with our American rights. And he's coming to challenge that. He says that proclaiming the path to happiness doesn't lie solely in that, defending our rights. So what does he mean, though, by exercise of virtues, most notably justice and charity?
I don't know.
What's the Pope's version of justice and charity?
Well, could it be the 55 million Waldenses that he killed? They killed over the would that be their justice and charity? You know, it reminds me, is it peace, Jehu? Is it peace?
Yeah.
Remember that in the Bible? Jezebel, is it peace, Jehu? What do you know about peace? He said. What is your
peace?
Yeah,
so
what
long
peace?
As your mother is
as
witchcraft.
Yeah, right.
So many.
Yeah, exactly. So they understood that Jehu, there's no peace. You know that there's no peace to the damned. And this Pope doesn't want
So they always have doublespeak though. When they say justice, they mean something else than you think. When they say charity, they mean something else than you think. They redefine all those words.
Yeah,
charity, for instance, he doesn't mean real charity. He means redistribution of wealth. Taking your money and giving it to someone else.
That's exactly what he means by that. By the way, you know, he's very charitable with our money.
Other people's money. Yep.
He's very charitable with the United States of America, the people of the United States of America, and
just
their
like
money,
the liberals.
Just like the liberals are, always charitable with somebody else's money.
That's right.
But I don't find him very charitable with his own,
right?
As he lives in the most expensive, and rules.
I don't see the Obamas very charitable with their own money when they take million-dollar vacations all the time.
Yeah, they love the poor. They're for the poor. As they, I don't know how many millions they've spent on vacations. It's astronomical.
Insane.
No president has spent that much money ever on vacations and traveling, ever. No president has ever done any of those things like that. None, except him. He has done more than his predecessors and then some. So I mean, it's ridiculous. But that's what they do. All right, he says. Let's see here. In these extraordinary comments, which constitute a frontal assault on the American idea of freedom and national sovereignty. Yes, see, I'm going to tell you why he has a problem with that. Because, right, the Pope has two keys, right? One temporal and one spiritual.
That's right.
And that little thing of a Declaration of Independence and a Constitution cuts into the idea. See, listen, we already know that our rulers have sold us down the river. But the Pope also knows that you have to have the people in order to do what you're going to do. Because if the people fight against you, if the people wake up, just like that's why they didn't want the Bible, the King James Bible, that Reformation Bible.
Give
they didn't
to
want
the
that.
Common man, yeah.
Right? Because once it got to the common man, then what happened? Then he had no power anymore. Because
when you break the spiritual power that they had over people, then you can break the temporal
power.
Break
the temporal power, that's right.
That's how it works.
That's
right.
Where
the spirit of the Lord is, there's liberty.
There's liberty. That's right. So that's what he knows, and he doesn't want that liberty.
You know
what? That liberty.
What was that guy, last name, Patrick Henry. I think he was one. You know what he said? When the people forget God, tyrants forge their chains.
Yep.
They're getting ready. Get ready to get enslaved.
Yep.
Get ready for a dictatorship. Get ready for fascism. When you forget God, when you reject God,
that's right.
You're going to lose all your freedom.
That's right. That's right. So now, what we see here is he wants national sovereignty
and freedom.
And freedom.
He's attacking it.
Sachs has made it clear that he hopes to enlist the Vatican in a global campaign to increase the power of global or foreign-dominated organizations and movements.
What does that mean? All about globalization.
Global or foreign-dominated organizations. What is that? Well, you know, I think it was the Supreme Court last year passed something about organizations and, you know, involvement in politics and all this stuff. And I think it opened up the door for more of this probably. But
yep.
Anyway, the thing is that what they're going to – he's going to use – the power of global or foreign-dominated organizations and movements to get what he wants.
It's simple. Diminish the power of America and increase the global governance power of the United Nations collective.
Exactly.
And we got to assimilate the United States into the Borg of the nations.
That's right.
The United
That's right.
Nations.
It's all communism. Sachs takes aim at the phrase which comes from America's founding document, the United States Declaration of Independence, that we hold these truths to be self-evident, that but they're self-evident. I see that. Isn't that interesting? That all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. There's two things that the Pope doesn't like. Okay? Well, there's more than two, but there's two that make sense of this article. Number one is freedom of conscience, freedom of religion. Number two is the right to keep and to bear arms. The Pope made it illegal back in the Dark Ages to have a crossbow.
Yep.
You could not defend yourself. You could not have a bow. He made it illegal. Why? Because the crossbow would go through the
armor.
The armor of the crusaders or whatever you call them, the knights or whatever. So he made it illegal that they couldn't have one. Now, what does he want to do here? Well, listen, I mean, you got the Word of God. That's first and foremost what you need, and that's what he hates. But if you get past the Word of God, you know, then we need to get rid of any weapons that you have, because you can't rise up against your persecutors or those that are terrorizing you. You cannot rise against them without weapons.
Now, let's talk about that for a second. It's the same order again. They attack the spiritual first to affect the temporal.
Right.
So how do
the
they
spiritual
attack
sword.
How do they attack our spiritual sword? I'll tell you how. The modern versions of the Bible.
That's right.
When they wanted to get that old King James out of our hands, because that was the Bible that was used. They used it. Yeah, they used, some people used the Geneva Bible when it came over here, but it eventually fell out of use, and the King James Bible dominated this country.
That's right.
Okay? All the way through the 1800s. And then Westcott and Hort came out with their text in the late 1800s, and then the Revised Version came out. And then, boom, after that, all the modern versions flooded. When did they flood? In the 20th century. And what has happened? More freedoms than we've ever lost. As a country, we become a wicked nation after we got rid of the King James Bible. The majority of churches today do not use the King James Bible. And all of the modern versions are based on the Vatican manuscripts of Vaticanus and Sinaiticus. All of them. They're all based on Vatican manuscripts. In addition to that, the text, the United Bible Society's text, who was on that committee? A Jesuit priest, a cardinal, his name is Carlo Montini. I think it's Martini or Montini, but he's a Jesuit on the commission for the to making the critical text underlying all modern versions. That is in a Vatican agenda. So what they do, they took away your spiritual sword. They took away the spiritual weapon from
all
these churches.
That was the first one they went against.
That's what they went against. And then what happened? Then after that, we have the attack on the Second Amendment. See how they did that? Take
yep.
away the spiritual weapon,
spiritual
then go after
sword
the carnal
first,
weapons.
Then go after the carnal sword, the fleshly one.
That's exactly how
it
works.
That's right. Well, he goes on to say this. He says, these rites sound good. No, Sax, they don't just sound good. They are good.
They are good.
Okay, and you know they're good. If they weren't good, you wouldn't want to be taking them away, now would you?
Yeah.
So quit with the games. It's ridiculous. It's a foolish argument is what it is. Well, they sound good. No, they are good, and you know it. You know they're good. That's what bothers you. That's why you want to take them away.
Yep.
Anyway, Sachs writes, but they're not enough to guarantee the outcome the global elites have devised for us. What in the world does that mean? That the global elites have devised for us. That doesn't sound good for the home team, does it? Anyway, so... for us. The global government, he suggests, must make us live our lives according to international standards of development.
See, so once again, they're saying we don't need to make decisions based off the Constitution and making, you know, decisions based off Congress and our checks and balances of our government. No, we need to listen to what the United Nations decides, and we need to obey what they decide.
Right, exactly. And this whole global – by the way – the only global government in the Bible is a one-world government that's the end times Antichrist government led by somebody like the false prophet and the Antichrist.
That's right.
And the papal
Revelation
system,
13.
The beast, the ten kings. Anyway, so that's another story for another day. But in the United States – oh, wait. Did I get all that?
No, you got it. Yep.
Oh, I got it. Okay. In the United States, Sachs writes, we learn that the route to happiness lies in the rights of the individual. By throwing off the yoke of King George III, by unleashing the individual pursuit of happiness, early Americans believed they would achieve that happiness. Most important, they believed that they would find happiness as individuals, each endowed by the Creator with individual rights. While he says there is some grandeur in this idea, such rights are only part of the story, only one facet of our humanity.
Oh, okay, so what's the other side then, Mr. Sachs?
Yeah, what is the other side? Sachs's view is that global organizations such as the UN must dictate the course of nations, and individual rights must be sacrificed for the greater good.
Of course.
What's the greater good to a Jesuit?
Well, the Jesuits have a saying called ad majorem de gloriam, which means for the greater glory of God. And their God is the God of this world.
That's right. Their God is Lucifer. That's
yep.
right. So, and the Pope is their God, okay? He is their God on earth.
Yep.
And they believe that, by the way.
Yep.
And by the way, they haven't changed anything, and they've never repealed any of those. They've never rescinded any of those.
Any of what?
Any of the papal bulls they put out right. concerning things. And if they did, they wrote them again.
Like the Council of Trent?
The Council of Trent has never been. Any of the councils? No, they've not. They've not.
In fact, they were reaffirmed.
That's right. That's right.
Okay.
So he says here that
Individual rights must be sacrificed.
Must
for the
be sacrificed
good.
For the greater good.
So you
got
to give up your freedoms
for the
greater
collective.
Good of the globe.
That's right.
Of the United
That's
Nations.
That's what they're saying. One aspect of this unfolding plan, as outlined in the Sachs book, The End of Poverty, involves extracting billions of dollars from the American people through global taxes.
See, they always use the poor to push their agendas. Yeah. Oh, but what about the poor? We need to help the poor. They just always come
so
back
we need
to that.
So we need to take your money to help the poor.
Exactly.
We will need, in the end, to put real resources in support of our hopes, he wrote. A global tax on carbon-emitting fossils, fuels.
Uh-oh.
Uh-oh.
See, here we go.
See, this is a tax on prosperity is what it is, by the way.
Carbon-emitting fossil fuel. A tax on carbon-emitting fossil fuels. What does that mean? That means, you know, fossil fuels, oil, gas, all that type of
everything
stuff.
Everything your products are everything made out of now, pretty much.
On, right.
Almost everything. I can't show you anything in this room. I couldn't go to any room in anybody's house right now.
Plastic.
That something's not made out of some petroleum-based oil,
right,
probably.
Exactly. All the plastic right. that we have.
Right.
But also, you know, the main thing they're talking about is, you know, things that run on gas.
Right.
Engines, stuff
right.
like that.
But it
so
affects
they want to tax
every
us.
Product, though.
Right.
Because you have
so
to get it to
tax
you.
Us for that because it's say they say that it causes, well, first they said global warming. And then they had to change that to climate change when it was proven. Remember those climate change? Remember the climate gate? Where they hacked into the emails and it was released
it was a big
that
lie.
They were intentionally manipulating the data that it wasn't real.
Yeah, and it came out and it pushed everything
it,
back
it
10 years.
It blatantly came out, but yet we're still hearing people push it as if it's not been disproven. It's just
because
insane.
They changed the name of it from global warming
to climate
change.
And you see, you have people out here like Bill Gates that treat you – I mean, not Bill Gates. Well, Bill Gates is one of them, but Bill Nye – the science guy who's saying the same thing, and he's treating you like if you don't believe in climate change, then you're a Nazi, you're an idiot.
He said you need medical help. You
yeah.
need to go to like a psychiatrist. Get
right.
Drugged.
Well, he said the same thing about creationists to teach your children creation that
right.
oh that we're he's like we need your children, and they can't be helpful to society if they're going to be learning that silly creation stuff.
No, they can't be indoctrinated with your education program, Agenda 21.
Yeah.
Right?
It's wicked.
Yep, climate deforming.
Hold on, one last thing. I'm sorry.
This
is the main point I didn't even say. So the whole point that they ever started this climate change stuff was so they could have the global tax,
right.
the carbon tax. That's what we wanted to do. Why? Because why is that so important? To redistribute the wealth, to weaken the middle class of America. That's a huge point that they want to do. Because when you weaken the middle class of America, those are the people that would be able to stand up against this
right.
New World Order agenda.
There's and, more of us, and they wouldn't be able to yeah. take over like
and,
this.
And they want to get rid of the middle class so there's only poor and super rich. That's it.
Right. That's right. So he says that yep. even a very small tax, less than that which is needed to correct humanity's climate-deforming overuse of fossil fuels, would finance a greatly enhanced supply of global public goods. Sachs has estimated the price tag for the U.S. at $845 billion.
So almost $1 trillion.
Almost $1 trillion.
And our debt now, our national debt is what, over $17 trillion? It's probably
oh, yeah,
higher
it's way
than
over
that.
I think it's like 19, yeah.
Yeah.
It's pretty bad. In preparation for this direct assault on our rights, the American nation... state and our founding document, United Nations Secretary General Ban Ki-moon told the Catholic Caritas International Conference in Rome. Well, what's he doing there? In Rome? On May 12th, that climate change is the defining challenge of our time and that the solution lies in recognizing that humankind is part of nature, not separate or above. Okay, now stop. Because here's what
no,
he's doing.
No, we are separate.
Yeah, we are
from
separate.
From nature.
Do you understand that this man went into a Catholic church and said that we are all part of nature, and they didn't blink or bat an eye at it?
Yep.
It didn't bother them one bit.
Because the Pope's on board with it.
Yeah, because that's their religion. That's the Pope's religion is Antichrist. That's what he is.
This next sentence is a mouthful, let me tell you.
I'll let you say it.
I don't mean hard words. I mean there's a lot of agenda in it. But I'll say it anyway. The Pope's expected encyclical on climate change is supposed to help mobilize the governments of the world in this crusade.
You did not
now
just
why,
use the word crusade.
Why did they use the word crusade?
Hey, there was a religious crusade, and that murdered a bunch of people and stole their wealth and raped their wealth from them. The Jews, the Arabs over there, okay, at that time. And then what does he say now? Now we have a global crusade, a world crusade. For what? An environmental.
But he wants to mobilize the governments of the world in this crusade.
But that's what he did before, because that's what he got kings to do. He got kings to invade Jerusalem.
He wants all the nations on his side for his crusade of this environmental Agenda 21, depopulation, New World Order.
Does
agenda.
Anybody else have like bells going off in their head right now over this? Like, this might just be like, but you don't think, surely you don't think the Pope has that much power, do you? I mean, he's not. I mean, he answers to all these Rothschilds and all these other people, right? The Pope couldn't possibly be able to do this. Well, he's walking right in and do it. And how is he doing it? Through flattery.
Yep.
He's doing it through flattery.
Yep.
I think people underestimate what the power that the Vatican holds.
Absolutely.
See, it's a sleight of hand type work. It's. What he does is puts out a bunch of front men out there while he walks around looking like some nice old man all day.
Yep.
Okay, and that's what they've always done. They've always made it look like they're the nice old man. Out there, they're not nice old men. They're really evil, rotten, disgusting, wicked people.
Yep.
All right, but a prestigious group of scholars, churchmen, scientists, economists, and policy experts has issued a detailed rebuttal entitled An Open Letter to Pope Francis on Climate Change. Pointing out that the Bible tells man to have dominion over the earth. Good climate policy must recognize human exceptionalism, the God-given call for human persons to have dominion in the natural world. And they use the Bible verse Genesis 1:28. And the need to protect the poor from harm, including actions that hinder their ascent out of poverty. The letter to Pope Francis states, released by a group called the Cornwall Alliance. So anyway, these guys want to battle that, want to fight that. We can stop. I mean, I don't know if there's any more in here that we need to really cover. Let's see. Well, this is interesting. Although Sachs likes to claim he was an advisor to the Pope, Pope John Paul II, the noted anti-communist and pro-life pontiff, Sachs simply served as a member of a group of economists invited to confer with the Pontifical Council on Justice and Peace in advance of the release of a papal document. In fact, Pope John Paul II had worked closely with the Reagan administration. Oh, really?
You mean Reagan, that great conservative champion?
He was the
champion of the
right.
conservatives, the great president of the past few decades.
You're a great American. You're a great American, right, Sean Hannity? You're a great American.
Yeah.
He loves Reagan. They like to blast Reagan. How great. I'm a Reagan conservative.
I've met many Christian Baptists that have said Reagan is their favorite president.
Yeah, I liked him for a long time until I understood what he really was about.
Right.
It took me a while to learn that. It took a lot of people a while to learn those things.
So I'd like to reiterate right now that the United States did not have diplomatic relations with the Vatican all the way up until what?
Ronald Reagan
reestablished those diplomatic ties.
Yes, he did.
That was very bad.
Yes, it was, and it opened the door for this right here, which was all part of the plan. In fact, Pope John Paul II had worked closely with the Reagan administration in opposition to communism and the global population control movement. Wait, Reagan was a part of the global population control movement?
No, I think in opposition to it. And on the surface, they're pretending that they're fighting against, we're against communism and population control.
He wants to complain
that
you
were trash that John Paul II was. I mean, give me a break.
Yeah, he was a real wicked man. He once complained that a UN conference on population issues was designed to destroy the family and was the snare of the devil.
Yeah, okay. I'm sure the Pope really believed that.
Yeah, right.
I mean,
Pope Francis, however.
You know, Pope John Paul II, the one who used to work for IG Farben, the ones who created Zyklon B, the chemical gas used to kill Jews in World War II. Oh, okay, the same guy?
You're not supposed to be learning facts according to Agenda 21. You're supposed to be learning, what was it, principles?
Values, yeah.
Values. You're supposed to be learning values, not facts.
Yeah, I'm not supposed to use facts. Okay, sorry.
The facts will get in the way. We don't want
supposed to have facts.
Away.
I'm not supposed to
You're
have
supposed
facts
to
about the popes and what they really did.
No, we're not supposed to have any facts, right? We're supposed to just
how
use
they helped
values.
The Nazis and they had it conquered out with the Nazis.
Yeah,
Nazi Germany. Oh, I forgot about that too.
Oh, wait, no, those are facts again. We're Agenda 21 says don't have any facts. Pope Francis, however, seems to have embraced the very movement supposed by John Paul II.
No, it's what it is. It's all sleight of hand, like you're saying. It's all an appearance. Pope John Paul II was never against that stuff.
No.
He just appeared to be – they have an open policy and they have a secret policy.
That's right.
And the secret policy is the true one.
That's
and
right.
Everything that they're for in secret is everything evil.
Yep.
Everything wicked. So Pope Francis is just coming out. He's the agent of change. He's the new guy. He's the John the Baptist for the Antichrist, paving the way. He's making the path straight for him and changing everything.
That's right. He sure is. Sachs, who has emerged as a very influential Vatican advisor, recently tweeted that he was thrilled to be at the Vatican discussing moral dimensions of climate change and sustainable development. Sustainable development. What's that?
It's a buzz phrase.
Yeah, it is. The occasion was a Vatican workshop on global warming on April 28th, 2015, sponsored by the Pontifical Academy of Sciences of the Roman Catholic Church. Sachs was a featured speaker. The plan going forward involves the launching of what are called Sustainable Development Goals, as envisioned by a Sustainable Development Solutions Network run by none other than Jeffrey Sachs. Oh, that's interesting. The network has proposed draft Sustainable Development Goals, which contain provisions that are radically antagonistic to the right to life from conception to natural death, to the rights and dignity of family, and to the rights of parents as the primary educators of their children, states the group Voice
now
of Family.
Now hold the phone. Did you hear that?
Yeah.
Contains provisions that are radically antagonistic. They're against the right to life from conception to natural death. They don't want you to have a choice in conception. That what did they say? We read that in another state earlier. Abortion, contraception, and sterilization.
Right. Which is interesting. Now you're at the Vatican and you're having a meeting, and you're on a group on a panel that believes these things. And remember what I told you guys about it? What is it, about 6 months to a year ago? I said he's going to pull all his funding for abortion. He's going to pull all his funding for those things.
Then we got the Year of Mercy right now. He's giving priests powers
exactly.
to forgive abortion.
Exactly. So he's pulling all the funding. It's all the handwriting's on the wall. He's telling you, I don't care if you kill your babies. We got to get population under control. I don't care about the family. I don't care about any of it anymore. It's all about the globalization.
Right.
Why? Because he can't come to his full rise in power and prepare the Antichrist kingdom without complete and total control of every government. And every nation.
Every aspect of life.
That's right.
So it's antagonistic to the right to life from conception. So they want to control you. They want to control how many children you can have or if you can have children.
Right.
Can you believe that?
The dignity of family and also, the rights of parents as the primary educators of their children.
Well, hold on. I want to talk about natural death, too, because you heard about the death panels.
Yep.
They want to be able to pull the plug on grandma.
Bill Gates says we're not supposed to talk about that, though.
Yeah, we're not supposed to talk about death panels.
But, you know, you got to either...
What did he say? You got to make a choice between what?
The teacher having a job or the 80-year-old grandma that's going to die anyway.
He wants to pull the plug on grandma.
Pull granny's plug. Grandma got run over by Bill Gates,
right? You know, man, there's a really good thing. There's a certain preacher who preached a sermon called about hospices. Hospice care?
Yeah.
Wow. We got to talk about that sometime.
It's interesting.
It is total depopulation. It goes right along with this agenda.
Wow.
They are taught to go in there and they kill people with morphine. They intentionally do it.
I believe it.
They kill people that are close to death. They give them more morphine, and it causes respiratory problems,
and
they
kill
them. Yep. Oh, man, I'm telling you, they're doing
it
right now.
We'll talk about that on another show for sure. That's part of the agenda, isn't
it? So from conception to natural death, they want to take away your right to choose.
By the way, so it says here that...
So the rights and dignity of the what?
Of the family and the rights of the parents as the primary educators of their children.
Okay.
So they want to, they don't like homeschooling.
They want to get rid of homeschooling and private schools and want everything to be federal public schooling.
Right. The state's the group voice of the family.
And rights and dignity of the family. Also, they want to take your right away, not only with education, but your right to make decisions about other things, like if you want to vaccinate your child.
Right.
If you want to discipline them biblically.
Right.
And what, you know, everything, every aspect of life, they want to control. And they want to take away the rights from the parent and make the state the parent of the children.
You know,
and now the children belong to the state.
Brother Nate, does this sound familiar, this plan? Before it was called Agenda 21, wasn't there a 10-point plan that somebody had? That we just talked about,
I believe,
in a sermon a week ago. And these things all eerily sound exactly the same. And it was Alice Bailey. Go back and listen to the sermon. Alice Bailey and her 10-point Luciferian plot to destroy America. And this Agenda 21 is the same because it was given to her by spirits. It was given to her by devils. Jwa Cool or whatever his name is. That's who gave her that.
And guess what? She had ties to the United Nations.
That's right.
And so where do you think they got the idea?
By the way, she had ties to the Roman Catholic Church, too.
Yep. And her husband, Foster Bailey.
Yeah, Bailey actually said that the Pope, Bailey actually said that the Christ, would come and indwell. Would probably indwell the Pope in Rome.
Yep.
And remember now, the Christ that she's preparing for was the Antichrist.
That's right, the New Age Christ.
That's interesting, isn't it?
Now, why would she say it would indwell the Pope? Yeah. A Luciferian, someone who originally had a company called the Lucifer Publishing.
Yeah.
Lucifer Publishing. Interesting.
Sure is. Go back and listen to that teaching if you haven't heard that yet.
All right. Global tax proposals.
Okay.
Do you got anything left in this article?
Sack says this. He says, Pope Francis will come to the United States and the United Nations in New York on the occasion of the 70th anniversary of the United Nations. And at the moment when the world's 193 governments are... Wow, I just seen that number. That's very interesting.
Yep.
When you add that number up, did you see that?
No.
Okay, anyway. 193 governments are resolved to take a... That's weird, isn't it? I mean, how can you make that up?
13, right?
Yeah, 13. That's weird. Resolved to take a step in solidarity towards a better world. On September 25th, Pope Francis will speak to the world leaders, most likely the largest number of assembled heads of state and government in history.
Wow. That's pretty crazy.
As these leaders deliberate to adopt new sustainable development goals for the coming generation, these goals will be a new worldwide commitment to build a world that aims to harmonize. I mean, can you get any more antichrist than these words? To harmonize the pursuit of economic prosperity and the commitments to social inclusion and environmental sustainability.
Now, hold on a second. There's a new world order, obviously. So we got economic prosperity. They want to do the redistribution of wealth. We got environmental sustainability. These are the things that we're talking about. But what else did they just say? Social inclusion.
Inclusion.
What do you think they mean about that? LGBT.
LGBT. That's right. That's the movement. That movement's on the rise, and we're going to be talking more about that this month.
They're
as
going
well.
To outlaw speech against those
That's
groups.
What they're working on. They want to put us in prison.
Hate
they want
speech
to shut
laws.
Us up. They want to
they
shut
want to
us
pass
up.
Pass hate speech laws.
Yep. Says, rather than emphasize the absolute need for safeguarding individual rights in the face of government overreach and power, Sachs writes that the gospel teachings of humility, love, you wicked, rotten devil. This man, I'll tell you what he's doing here. What he's doing here, he said, listen to this. This is nothing but antichrist speech right here. It is so wicked. It's straight from Lucifer's lips right here.
Yep.
Listen to what he says here. Rather than emphasize the absolute need for safeguarding individual rights in the face of government overreach and power.
Yeah, we shouldn't worry about the federal government getting out of control and turning into a tyrannical dictatorship and taking away our rights.
Like every world government that dominated the world did.
Yep.
Every single one of them.
And every democracy always turns into dictatorship.
Right, and what they take away, the freedom of speech, freedom of religion, and freedom of the sword, to have the sword, the right
Second
of just
Amendment,
defense.
Right.
The right of just defense. So what do they want to do? They want to take those things away. They want to take all the – why? So you can't defend – and he's saying, oh, you got to just give in to the government. I mean, you just got to understand
the
gospel.
Yeah, you don't need to worry about that.
What is he telling you the gospel teaches you? He's telling you the gospel teaches you to submit to tyranny.
That's right.
To submit to wicked devils.
That's right.
To submit to that wicked pope in Rome.
Yep.
That's what he's telling you, to submit to Antichrist.
That's right.
That's the indoctrination that's going on here. And if you think I'm upset, you better believe it. I'm ticked because that's exactly what he's pushing.
Listen, look at what the next thing he says, and it proves what spirit he's of.
Sachs writes, the gospel teachings of humility, love, and justice, like the teachings of Aristotle, Buddha, and Confucius?
Wow.
What is that Antichrist? That's not the gospel of the Bible. He's preaching the Antichrist religion.
The one world religion.
I mean, folks.
Right in your face.
If you can't see this, you're blind as a bat spiritually. You need to get saved. If you can't see what they're doing, if you can't see what this man is doing, what these groups of people are doing, I mean, the fix
now,
is in, folks.
Listen,
it's in.
Did you notice what he just did? He said the gospel teachings, and then he listed Aristotle, Buddha, and Confucius. He didn't mention Jesus when mentioning the word gospel.
No, of course not.
So he related gospel to these other false
right.
gods and left out Jesus.
Right.
Who's the only one that preaches
the
gospel?
Right, and by the way, his gospel, the Bible says, if any man preach any of the gospel than that which you've received, let him be accursed.
But he calls it the gospel
right.
teachings.
And
right. they capitalized the G on gospel and
yep.
then mentioned Aristotle, Buddha, and Confucius.
Yeah. I mean,
wow.
you couldn't make it any easier for us. Folks, I'm telling you, people, you better wake up out there and see what's really going on here. It's unbelievable.
So he said these teachings can take us on a path to happiness through compassion and become our guidepost back to safety.
Look at what he says, the path to happiness.
So we want happiness and safety.
Let me help you with something.
That's what
okay?
they want. Happiness and safety.
Now,
they
I don't
always
agree
emphasize
with
that.
The part of the Declaration of Independence that says the pursuit of happiness. Yeah, that's a humanistic principle, okay? We understand that, okay? But that's not the goal of the Declaration of Independence. The Declaration of Independence was to recognize that we have certain inalienable rights.
Protect
okay?
life, liberty,
and the
property.
Right, and property. It was the pursuit of happiness was not the intent of those men. That wasn't their. That wasn't the main thrust of what they were saying. What they were saying is just liberty, to be free, to be able to do.
Well, they're,
to,
they're
to
saying
own property,
you're free to pursue anything you want.
Right.
Whatever makes
right.
you happy. Any
right.
career you want, whatever you want to do.
And you can listen. Gerald Finney wrote more on that as far as the humanistic principles, because that is a humanistic principle, the pursuit of happiness, okay? And I get that, and I agree with him when he says that. But the point is what he's saying here, though, is he's concentrating on the pursuit of happiness. Like, well, you Americans, you just want to be happy and you're reckless at any cost. Well, that's not really the case. I mean, it is with some people. But the point is what they want to concentrate on is liberty they want to steal from us.
Yep.
They don't want you the right to choose what you will do.
All right. You need to read this last paragraph because it's a doozy.
Writing elsewhere in the new issue of America, Christiana Z. Pepard, an assistant professor of theology, science, and ethics at Fordham University?
Jesuit University.
Jesuit Fordham University. Oh, my word. Writes about the planetary pope?
Planetary pope.
Is that like Captain Planet?
It sounds like it.
I wonder if they're going to play that theme song when he comes out.
No,
the Captain
listen,
Planet theme
they
song.
They are making Pope Francis Captain Planet.
He is like Superman. He
yeah.
is Captain Planet.
He's coming
hero.
In and he's going to save the world.
Do you think
from
he has Earth, Wind,
destroying
Fire,
it?
And...
He's heart.
He's heart? He's the heart one. Okay. You know, saving the planet is the thing to do, is what Captain Planet said.
That's right.
You know, but
hey, Ted Turner, the same guy who said a 95% in present reduction of population levels would be ideal. Yeah, that same guy.
Oh boy, the real question. I listen to this anyway. So let's go back here. The planetary pope. He's a planetary pope. Can I change it to planetary poop? Anyway, what is really at stake in the collective response to the pope's encyclical? Is not ultimately whether our treasured notions of theology, science, reality, or development can accommodate moral imperatives. The real question is whether we are brave enough and willing to try.
Is that what they call it, a brave new world?
That brave new world, that's right. That's why they call it that. Huxley, right? The brave new world?
So what? How,
the plan is quite simple.
Sums it up.
The plan is quite simple. World government through global taxes? With a religious face to bring it about.
Yep.
And that, my friend, is the definition of revelation. That is a definition Revelation of the 13. 10th kingdom. That's right. Of the 10 kingdoms and the 10 kings and the beast and the woman that rides the beast that rides in this wave. This is, I mean, you can't get any more blunt than this, more straightforward than this. It's oozing with it. It's just ridiculous.
Absolutely.
Man.
All right. I just wanted to hit a couple high points from this other article because it talks a little bit more about some statements. I want to read some of the statements that Pope Francis actually was saying. It's from this article from TheGuardian.com. Explosive intervention by Pope Francis set to transform climate change debate. So this encyclical that he's written is going to be – it's the most anticipated letter, papal letter for decades and will be published in 5 languages, okay? And it will call for an end to the quote-unquote tyrannical exploitation of nature by mankind. So Pope Francis – will call for an ethical economic revolution to prevent catastrophic climate change. A revolution. An ethical and economic revolution. That's what he's pushing. And growing inequality in a letter to the world's 1.2 billion Catholics on Thursday. In an unprecedented encyclical on the subject of the environment, the pontiff is expected to argue that humanity's exploitation of the planet's resources has crossed the Earth's natural boundaries and that the world faces ruin without a revolution in hearts and minds. Why is he talking about that revolution, first of all? But he's talking about in hearts and minds. He wants to change people's hearts and minds.
We know what the popes mean and the Jesuits mean by... Now, I want you to keep in mind something. I find it fascinating. And I'm sorry I go back to this, but I find it absolutely fascinating. Now, from record... Now, I don't know if this is true, Nate. Maybe you can... Historically, you have some insight on this too as well, but this Pope is the first Jesuit to ever be the Pope. Is that correct? And that's what they say anyway, that this Pope is actually the first openly to be a Jesuit. Let's put it that way.
I think he is, yeah.
You know, openly.
Or he might be the second. I can't remember either. But, yeah, I forget.
But openly to proclaim it that he's a Jesuit, yeah. Right. Now, he says, and he also says that he wants to be treated, I mean, he bowed to the Jesuit priest or the Black Pope, which, by the way, he owned that title the other day. I saw a news article, or I saw a live radio taped video of the Pope, the Black Pope, and he actually owned that title of Black Pope right there on the screen, which they usually don't like to do, but he owned it, which I thought was interesting. It was in Brazil or another country, Brazil or one of those countries over there. Anyway, the point is that this Pope is everything that he's doing is I find it fascinating that he's a Jesuit, because you couldn't fit the Jesuit playbook any better than he has. I mean, it's absolutely uncanny how he is just following the Jesuit playbook to a T. Like, he's not – I mean, he's doing everything that a Jesuit would do, the way that he would do it, the slimy, slick, weaselly way that he does everything. And everybody loves him. Do you know he has a better – he is as a world leader, he has, like, the highest approval rating.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Among all different types of groups of people.
Yeah, exactly.
So I want to read a couple other things here. The Ghanaian cardinal – it's a cardinal from the country of Ghana in Africa – Peter Turkson, president of the Vatican's Pontifical Council for Justice and Peace and close ally of the Pope – will launch the encyclical. By the way, I want you guys to keep an eye on that guy, Peter Turkson. He's a strange character. We'll see in the future. He has said it will address the root cause of poverty and the threats facing nature or creation. In a recent speech widely regarded as a curtain raiser to the encyclical, Turkson said, quote, listen to this, much of the world remains in poverty despite abundant resources. While a privileged global elite controls the bulk of the world's wealth and consumes the bulk of its resources. Yeah. Listen, you see how they always act like they're not part of that global elite? They right. are the global elite controlling the bulk of the world's wealth and consuming its resources.
Yeah, exactly.
They are the ones. The Vatican is in control of the world's wealth, okay? The Vatican wealth. And the Rothschilds and those other bankers and the Rockefellers are the Vatican's bankers, and we will prove it, and through the Knights of Malta, we will prove it in the future. But anyways, that's a joke. The Argentinian pontiff is expected to repeat calls for a change in attitudes to poverty and nature. Quote, an economic system centered on the god of money needs to plunder nature to sustain the frenetic rhythm of consumption that is inherent to it, he told a meeting of social movements last year. I think a question that we are not asking ourselves is, isn't humanity committing suicide with this indiscriminate and tyrannical use of nature? Safeguard creation, because if we destroy it, it will destroy us. Never forget this. So, isn't that a pantheistic principle? Isn't this a principle that if we destroy the earth, it will destroy us? What about God? What about God here? He doesn't talk about God's judgment or anything like that. He just says the earth will destroy us if we destroy it. What do you think he means by that? The earth will destroy us. Well, one thing that I can think of is there's a little thing called HAARP.
Yep.
It's H-A-A-R-P, if anyone's not familiar with that. It stands for High Frequency Active Auroral Research Program. And basically what they do is they have a, I believe it's over a million watts or a billion, I don't know, it's a really lot amount of wattage that they shoot into the atmosphere. They shoot a beam into the ionosphere, heats it up, bends back down, shoots back into the earth, and it can create earthquakes. There's also, if you research that a little bit more, this is open information. Anybody can go research this, what HAARP is and what it can do.
Yep.
And they can create earthquakes. It can alter the weather. It can also supposedly get into people's minds. That's been proven as well, that they can inject messages into people's minds. It can be used for mind control. It's a pretty interesting device, very dangerous piece of technology.
Yes, it is.
But the point is, you could cause an earthquake, and then you could blame it on climate change and say, see what we're doing and see how it's affecting the earth, and now the earth is destroying us because we're destroying it. But in reality, they're the ones that caused it with the HAARP.
Yeah, there's another interesting thing that some people comment on, and I've not studied it out, okay? So I'm just throwing this out there as a comment. But every time they ramp up CERN and right. talk about that, there seems to be some dangerous things that happen in the weather and you know, you can go search it out yourself. Again, I'm not saying that's true. I'm saying that's what people have reported.
Right.
I don't know the case. I'm not sure about that. I've not studied CERN out like I need to, but I thought that was an interesting point when I heard
yep.
somebody say that.
Now, there's a movie you can watch. You want to learn more about HAARP. It used to be called Weapons of Tesla. Something about, I forget the full name of it, but there's a book called Angels Don't Play This HAARP. You can look that up. But then also there's chemtrails, which is also known as geoengineering. A lot of people say, oh, you believe in chemtrails? I can't believe that. Well, listen. Go look up geoengineering. They have admitted it in Congress that it's a fact that they've been doing it already. And they are releasing aluminum and barium and other metals and chemicals, particulates, into the atmosphere. They're seeding the clouds. And guess what? It changes weather. It alters weather patterns. It alters the soil and the water. It's affecting that. Here's one interesting fact. People who have found to have Alzheimer's, they were found to have high concentrations of aluminum in their brains. And aluminum is one of the things that they're spraying in these chemtrails. And they've been documented. You can look up, you can watch the movie, What in the World Are They Spraying? And they show they take samples from the soil and they prove that that's one of the things that they're proving. Actually, aluminum is very dangerous in you consuming that, one of the heavy metals. So anyways, what's the point of making? They can alter the weather.
Yep.
And to pretend and say that, oh, look at what we're doing. We're causing climate change, and now the earth is trying to destroy us, when in reality they're the ones that have been affecting the change the whole time.
Right.
So here's what's interesting. The encyclical will go much farther than strictly environmental concerns, says Vatican insiders. Pope Francis has repeatedly stated that the environment is not only an economic or political issue, but is an anthropological and ethical matter. Keeps focusing on that. He wants a revolution of ethics in the hearts and minds
of
people.
He's changing the ethics is what he's doing. That's what Jesuits do. And what he's doing is he's changing the ethics, saying the environment is more important than your family.
Well, here's what he means by this.
Mother Earth.
It says right here, this guy, Barreto Jimeno of Peru, this archbishop, this is what he says. It will address the issue of what? Inequality and the distribution of resources. Like we were talking about earlier, what do they want to do? Redistribute the wealth through the global government of the United Nations or whatever global government will be in power. They want to take your resources and distribute it to other people. And they're going to take most of it for themselves. It also will address the issue of inequality of topics such as what? Wasting food and the irresponsible exploitation of nature and the consequences of people's life and health. So they want to control every aspect of your life, like we were saying. Continuing on, the now here's another point. They say this. Who said this? He was echoed by Cardinal Oscar Rodriguez Maradiaga of Honduras, who coordinates the Vatican's Inner Council of Cardinals and is thought to reflect the Pope's political thinking. So this guy is thought to reflect the Pope's political thinking. Well, what does he say? Quote, the ideology surrounding environmental issues is too tied to capitalism that doesn't want to stop ruining the environment because they don't want to give up their profits. What is he doing here? Attacking capitalism. And instead of capitalism, what are they pushing? A communist system, right? Redistribution of wealth, all these other types of things. They are attacking. They want to get rid of that capitalistic system. Why? Because that is how the middle class of America, they got their wealth through the capitalistic system. They went out. They were able to get an education, make a living for themselves, get a good career. They were able to have a nice house and have property and all these types of things, right? Well, you can't have that if you don't have a capitalistic system, because the government decides how much money you can have, where you work, how much you work,
yep,
what you own, everything. And that the middle class is completely eliminated, and you only have the super poor and the rich. That's why they hate capitalism. They want the middle class gone, the middle class of America. They want it destroyed. It's one of the biggest agendas.
That's right.
So, because we oppose they have the to have new that, world order.
Right, because yeah. Plus the middle class here in America, I guarantee if you did a study on who the middle class are, you will find that they are probably predominantly Protestant, Baptist or Protestant in their faith. Or fundamental of some sort in the middle class of America.
Some sort of Christian profession.
Whether it's they're actually saved or not, it's another. But they would still go by biblical principles
yeah,
for government and for other things, even if they're not saved, right? Yeah. But the Pope is changing the entire Catholic Church around. Well, he's just revealing what the hidden doctrine has always been. But anyway, that's what he's doing, and you're finding that in America, there's going to be a very small remnant of Bible believers, and as there are now, that are standing in his way, and he doesn't want them to be in his way anymore. He is tired of them being in his way, and he wants them out of his way.
Absolutely.
So that's what's going on.
All right. So finishing this up, it just basically says that he's increasingly seen as the voice of the global South and a catalyst for change in global bodies. In September, he will seek to add impetus and moral authority to UN negotiations in New York to adopt new development goals and lay out a 15-year global plan to tackle hunger, extreme poverty, and health. He will also address the UN General Assembly on September 23rd as countries finalize their commitments. So he's supposed to be the most radical. Where did I just read? I just read
radical,
that statement.
Radical.
He is personally committed. Pope Francis is personally committed to this climate issue like no other pope before him. The encyclical will have a major impact. It will speak to the moral imperative of addressing climate change in a timely fashion in order to protect from the most vulnerable. It said something about he's the most radical about the environment and climate change than any other pope.
Right. Yep, it's time. It's their time to unveil this. It's the secret. This is nothing more than the teachings of Philando Blavatsky and all the other
Agenda
Satanists.
21.
And Agenda 21, Alice Bailey's 10-point plan, the Luciferian plan to guard Mother Earth. I mean, all of these things are nothing more than they're just now. It's the secret doctrine. It's what they've been holding on to, and now they're saying now it's time to implement it. And make no mistake about it, you have the largest. Billion man army, so to speak, of very wealthy people headed up by the Pope in Rome and the Vatican and their money supply that are going to push this and their organization. Who, listen, think about this, okay? How many Catholic parishes are there around the world? Where are they not? They're everywhere. There's nowhere they're not. They're even in countries of extreme persecution from Islam. They're still in those countries, okay? And they are in everywhere. So where better? Who better to push this than the Pope that's going to push this everywhere?
Right, absolutely. So I just wanted to read one last paragraph from this and then one last thing about Agenda 21. We'll wrap this up. So this says, the Pope is aiming at a change of heart. Like I'm saying again, that's the main thing. What will save us is not technology or science. What will save us is the ethical transformation of our society.
Transformation.
Ethical transformation. They keep focusing on it. It's all about the ethical transformation, not political.
They got, but they got to have that transformation, though, don't they? It's very important.
Right.
When they change, by the way, that part of that transformation is the LGBT transformation.
Yep.
Like we talked about, that's that transformation. I mean, that's, we're seeing that. I mean, the Pope met with the devil's daughter. Remember that?
Yep.
Go back and listen to that Pope Watch, and you'll hear that.
All right. So one last thing, summing this up, bring it back to Agenda 21, because that's exactly what he's pushing.
What it is.
Let's summarize that by saying this. For those who may not be familiar with Agenda 21, we could probably go into that more in future shows. We could break down.
Yeah, there's a lot we could do with that.
Well, also the report from Iron Mountain I want to cover, yep, and some other documents. So let's summarize it by saying that it essentially involves every policy initiative that pushes the world toward total UN control. It involves everything from gun control to parental rights. The plan is to strip all individuals of their rights to private property, herd us into dense population centers, and control us like cattle. They also intend to drastically reduce the human population. That is also a huge goal of climate change and environmentalism, is to reduce the population. And we'll talk about that. You're probably going to do a video soon on the Georgia Guidestones.
Right.
Which talks about maintain humanity under 500 million.
Yep. I'm going to bring that video back when I get up to Atlanta, and then you and I will work on
the
that.
The Ten Commandments of the New World Order, they call that, Georgia Guidestones.
Yep.
So they intend to drastically reduce the human population from its current number of about 7 billion to around 500 million because they fear that human beings consume too much and the population growth is too much for the planet to handle. No, what they really want is it's easier to control a lower population. Less people, easier to control. That's what it's all about. And Satan loves killing people.
Yep.
You know, more people that are dead in their sins will just go straight to hell before they hear the gospel.
That's what it's all about.
He loves to steal, kill, and destroy. Okay, they fear the human being, blah, 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 too much to the planet. For those who refuse to entertain that anyone could believe such a thing, let's look at this quote from the Initiative for the United Nations ECO 92 Earth Charter. Here's a quote from this. The present vast overpopulation, now far beyond the world's carrying capacity, cannot be answered by future reductions in the birth rate due to contraception, sterilization, and abortion, but must be met in the present by the reduction in the numbers presently existing. This must be done by whatever means necessary.
Ooh, listen to that state. By any means necessary.
They want to reduce the population by whatever means necessary. Which means, hey, what if we reduce a bird flu engineered in a lab that would kill millions of people? You think they might do that?
Or vaccines?
Or through the vaccination, you could also
or
spread
disease. Or through soft killing?
Through soft killing, through disease.
Through your water?
Through maybe World War III. Could also, a lot of people could die.
Poisoning food supply? Genetically
many
modified food?
Things. Yeah. But they said contraception, sterilization, abortion, that's just not enough. We got to kill them. Wait, you got to start lowering those numbers a lot faster.
Yeah, that's success for them.
So that's exactly. So it's part of an official UN document concerning the agenda to combat global warming or climate control. Abortion and birth control were part of the human depopulation agenda. Okay.
Wow.
They admit it in the official UN document.
Well, that's nice of them.
So.
And the Pope's on. And by the way, the Pope's on board with it. He likes it. He's on board with it. He's the one that headed it up in the first place. So.
Oh, so something else that's interesting. Did you know that the U.S. has a patent on the current Ebola virus?
You know, I've heard that. I've heard that. Why? How can the U.S. have a patent on that? How does that work?
I wonder.
Hmm.
Did you know that there's a guy in Minnesota who's working on really nasty diseases in a lab trying to supposedly create cures, but what he does is he creates even more
nasty diseases.
Nasty strains of those illnesses.
Yeah, there's one. I don't remember which state it's in. There's one state in America, and I don't remember which it is, but there's a disease, and it's on a university, and they've developed it in a lab. And even the professors of that lab have said this – the head of this lab is absolutely insane to develop this disease.
Yep.
Because if it ever gets out, there's no cure for it, and you cannot resist it. There's nothing that can resist
right.
it.
Right, and it's like a, what, 90% kill rate or something?
Yeah.
You just,
and they're growing it in the lab. Now, why would they do that?
Exactly. So one last thing, because I just found this quote, and then we'll end it. This is a good quote, though, because the Club of Rome, they're a huge part of this depopulation agenda, okay?
Wow.
I want to leave you with one more quote from a document entitled The First Global Revolution. It outlines the motivations behind the green agenda and allows you to see exactly what type of people with which we are dealing. They are earth-worshipping pagans who believe that you are responsible for the death of the planet, and they are intent on following through with what they started. Now listen to this quote. Pay attention. The common enemy of humanity is man. In searching for a new enemy to unite us, we came up with the idea that pollution, the threat of global warming, water shortages, famine, and the like would fit the bill. All these dangers are caused by human intervention, and it is only through changed attitudes and behavior that they can be overcome. The real enemy, then, is humanity itself. That's from the Club of Rome. They said that, okay? What did they say? The new enemy to unite us. They're saying that the only way they could unite the world in a global government is through these environmental causes, the climate Wow. change issue. That's what they chose to use. Water shortages, famine, pollution, all these types of things. That would unite humanity together in a one world government.
Wow. Amazing, so, isn't it? So the Pope and Agenda 21.
Yep,
they're all on board for it, and we'll be updating you as new information comes out.
Did you notice something though? You know what that document was called?
Hmm.
The First Global Revolution.
The First Global Revolution.
What was the Pope Francis talking about? He kept saying a revolution.
A revolution.
A revolution in hearts and minds.
That's right. That's right. Well, that's their goal, isn't it?
And that, we know where that leads to. I think he might have been repeating the Club of Rome's plans.
Yeah, well, he probably instituted it, so yep. Or one of his minions before him.
Yep.
So, unfortunately, this is the truth of the matter. What's going on? And keep your eyes. We'll keep reporting as soon as we see things. When we see them, we'll let you know
we'll
about
them. We'll keep Pope watching.
Yeah, we'll keep Pope watching and let you know what's going on and what the plan is as we see it unfold here. But you keep being in prayer and keep trusting the Lord. These things ought not make you afraid. They ought to make you rejoice, because all they do is just prove that the Bible is true. They just prove that this is what's coming.
Jesus is coming soon.
That's right.
Too. That's
the
what
Lord
it means.
Jesus Christ is going to break the bands of these wicked devils, and he's going to stomp on them, and he's going to reign victoriously.
He that sitteth in the heavens shall laugh.
That's right.
The Lord shall have him in derision.
That's right. They don't have anything on the Lord Jesus Christ.
God's
you know
laughing
what?
At the New World Order.
That's right, he is. And you know what? They don't have anything on us either.
That's right.
Okay, because
God
we're saved
us,
by the
no,
blood.
Who can be against us?
That's right. We're saved by the blood of the Lamb, so we don't have to worry about anything what's coming. We know the judgment is going to come, and the worst thing that can happen to us is we get a promotion, okay? So and we die and we go to heaven. Amen. And so we just keep being faithful to the Lord Jesus Christ. For Brother Nate Marino's, Pastor Jason Cooley, for Sound the Battle Cry Radio Ministry.
Rouse then, soldiers, rally round the banner, ready, steady, pass the word along. Onward, forward, shout aloud, Hosanna, Christ is captain of the mighty throng. Strong to meet the foe, marching as we go, while our cause we know must prevail. Shield and banner bright, gleaming in the light, battling for the right, we ne'er can fail. When the battle's done and the victory's won, may we wear a crown before thy face. Rouse then, soldiers, rally round the banner, ready, steady, pass the word along. Onward, forward, shout aloud, Hosanna, Christ is captain of the mighty.